Well, thanks for tuning in and joining. Let's start over.
It's a good start, isn't it?
Well, okay. Thanks for tuning in and joining us on NASCAR Inside NEXTEL Cup. I've been gone for a few weeks, Mikey. We've got highlights of the trucks who were parked in their shops because they didn't race, so I guess we don't have highlights. But we've got the Busch cars and the NEXTEL Cup cars from Michigan. Didn't know who the winner was going to be till right at the very end, so stay tuned and we'll be right back. We're not going to redo this, are we?
Your mileage may vary. Jeremy Mayfield's mileage was very, very good on Sunday and got him a trip to Victory Lane at the Michigan International Speedway. Welcome to the $3,686 per gallon edition of Inside NEXTEL Cup Racing. I'm Alan Bestwick. A very entertaining race at Michigan on Sunday, capped off with a running on fumes finish, and Jeremy Mayfield's team calculating their strategy just right to pick up their first win of 2005. The original expert panel is all gassed up and ready to go in our Charlotte studios with another round of insightful analysis for you that hopefully doesn't coast to a halt before our checkered flag waves. We welcome to the program Michael Waltrip, driver of the Napa Chevy for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, Johnny Benson, driver of the Toyota Certified Used Vehicles Tundra for Bill Davis Racing. I'll let you get that in a minute, Mike. And Ken Schrader, driver of the Schwann's Dodge for BAM Racing. You wanted to say...
And the State Fair brand corn dog Chevy. No, it was a Dodge, wasn't it?
Dodge that week.
Yeah. So anyway, Chevy this week for Johnny. He's my driver.
It's all I could do to get that first title out there in one piece.
Yeah.
Yeah.
His car said corn dogs right on the side of it. I love that.
Yes, it did.
So did my suit.
Yeah.
That was cool.
It was cool.
It was neat.
Well, maybe you can do it some more.
We might.
From my side, Sunday's finish was kind of crazy, trying to figure out who was where, on what strategy, who was going to make it to the finish, who was in trouble. I don't know. What was it like from you guys in the cars?
Well, mine was interesting, and this comes from the department of be careful what you wish for. You might get it.
Uh-huh.
We topped off with one to go, and Tony Jr. told me that if I could save him one lap's worth of gas, I would make it to the end. So I saved gas, ran half throttle, drafted, eased into the gas, and eased off the gas. We never got a caution. I was happy about that because I thought, I'm going to pull something off here. And I ran out with two to go. So I surmise
he meant three laps.
No, I think he meant one, but I think my efforts at saving gas cost us a lap. I think I probably didn't do it right or something. And they said, you're going to run out with one to go. And I saved all I could, and I ran out with two to go. So that didn't work out.
And we haven't seen that in quite a while. I mean, that's been the first time.
Oh, it was fun, too.
Yeah.
My car was the best it had been all day long at the end. As good at the beginning, as bad in the middle, good at the end. And I was loose a little bit, so I thought, man, I'm saving all kinds of gas. It's going to be perfect. I'm going to get all the way to the end. I'm going to make it. So I didn't want the caution to come out, and it didn't. And I finished 27th.
It worked out too well for you. There's going to be some comments about stealing a win on fuel mileage, but...
You know what?
Those comments
will last for two or three weeks, and then it's like when you make a par. If you bounce it off a tree into the hole, it's still a par. You know, he's still going to have a one in the win column, and there's not going to be an asterisk by it.
200 laps. He was the first one to get there. Bottom line, he won a race.
And he was smart. He had a decent car. I ran with him most of the day. We weren't very good, but we weren't bad. But he was there when they wrote the checks, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm.
I'm proud of him. I think that's cool. You got to get him any way you can. Yeah. I know he's lost one like that. I've probably lost some like that. We've all been on either side of that fence, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah. Here's the thing about them making the fuel gamble to me. They started the day only 94 points ahead of 11th place in the championship. If it didn't work out, they'd have finished 26th.
But that's where they were running most of the time. You know, they're probably 18th, somewhere in there. And so it's worth a gamble.
Look there, State Fair corn dog Chevrolet.
The
right on TV. Did y'all see that?
The
National
risk.
TV.
National TV, Kenny Wallace.
What they could gain was a lot more than what they could lose.
Risk-reward. Yep. They weighed it out. Plus, Slugger's a gambler. You know, he thought, I can make this. And they probably had good data on what kind of mileage they were getting. So
ours is fluctuating a bunch.
Yeah, mine does too. When I try to save some, I use them. Listen to this. He said you got 4.4 and 4.3. If you save some,
gallon.
All you need to get is 4.5. You'll make up.
Yeah, we can
Around, I drive around in my Chevy Suburban with the mileage thing on there, and I drive to save gas because it's so expensive. I'll roll off, and I try to get my thing to give me 17.6 and 17.7. So I said, I've got this.
You need one of them little things in your race car.
You know what I needed? I needed my roof to be a little lower. Then I would have slipped through the air. If my roof was lower, I could have gotten through the air better and got better mileage.
Well, rumor has it that our roof was a little too low.
Oh, really? I hadn't heard that.
Yeah, I heard that last night.
Really? What are they going to do about that? 25 points?
Well,
25
I'll
grand?
I have to get back with you.
Well, I'm glad my roof wasn't too low then, but it would have helped me, I bet.
A little less wind resistance.
That's right. But greasing through the air.
We pitted with like 15 or 20 to go and took the two tires and tried to split that run up.
Right. How'd that work?
Well, I don't know. Even with my low roof, I mean, if it even helped a little bit, but I was ahead of your car. So,
right.
Of course, you coasted for three laps.
Right.
So.
Yeah. I had a plan and it didn't work out. But
How many times has that happened?
Well, you know what? It usually works out. When Tony Jr. said I could make it, I wrote it down.
Well, he's
a smart dude, and I said, I just got to save him a little gas, and I'm going to finish in the top five.
Well, and what they're doing on the gas is we've checked the fuel mileage all week in practice. Every time we make a run during the race, they're weighing the gas that doesn't go in plus the gas that comes out of the overflow. I mean, they're not guessing. I mean, they're guessing.
Well, they get
but
it
they're using
a lap or two
all their every available piece of knowledge that they can use to come up with an exact thing. And and sometimes it just isn't exact.
And that's why I think it's really important to remember as we end this segment, be careful what you wish for. No, please no caution, please no caution. Oh, shoot, I'm out of gas.
Yeah, I mean, use that caution.
Darn.
Hate it for you.
Yeah, well, life goes on.
And the show goes on. A few things to check up on from this past week headline-wise. Crew Chief Tony Urie Jr. has signed a long-term contract with Dale Earnhardt Incorporated to remain with the team. It was announced this week. Much speculation that Tony Jr. will be Dale Jr.'s crew chief next season. No confirmation from any of the involved yet. We move on to left front tires because NASCAR instituted a new camber minimum on the left front corners of the cars this week. 8 degrees is all you can do for that left front in an effort to try and eliminate some of those issues on that corner of the car. And also something new started Sunday at Michigan. NASCAR will also check the air pressure on the cars just before the start of each race for the foreseeable future. They're trying to build a database of information to see if there's any correlation between the air pressures the teams are using to start these races on and some tire problems that might happen early in those races. How about the camber thing? Change your car setups much
didn't
for Michigan?
Didn't make any difference. All they're doing
not for Michigan. I meant there's a lot of tracks you're going to run a lot more camber. And they just want to make sure you're just not over on that edge. There's probably about a spot that they're thinking that, okay, this might be a little bit too far, but I think the air pressure's got a lot to do with it too. Now they're just checking air pressure, not telling you where you have to run it, but Goodyear has a recommended air pressure where you want. We always start lower than that because it gains so much air during a race, and they feel at times that it hurts it just in that first 5 to 10 laps, and then that's usually when the damage is done, but it sometimes doesn't show up until later in the run.
And as I understand it, just from talking to different crew chiefs, the left front camber issue has more to do with how the tire travels, the way the soft springs are and where it ends up during.
Yeah, but they're just checking it at static where it's just sitting there in the garage. They're not telling you where it's got to be when the car is down in the racetrack. So, I mean, everybody worked around that and still running it just where they want.
Right, I guess my point was what the crew chiefs are telling me is it isn't necessarily where the tire starts at static, but it's where it ends up in travel.
It's definitely not at 8 degrees of travel.
Yeah.
You know, it's less than that.
It pulls the camber out of it when it travels, whereas the right front pulls it into it.
We got too technical there, didn't we?
I followed along pretty good, so it couldn't have been very technical.
I was surprised that you were still following.
Well, there for a minute I was thinking about what I was going to do later on today because I kind of got bored with it all, but then I caught up at the end and decided.
Appreciate you coming back to us.
Yeah, thank you. Macy's with me today, so that's a good day.
She is.
She's in the control room.
then if she'll please roll this next piece of videotape, we'll move on with the rest of our show. Thank you, Mace. Here's what's coming up. Our expert panel taking you through the Michigan race. Next, we'll talk some trash while we're at it. Late laps pass for the win in Saturday's NASCAR Busch Series race. Highlights later. Your questions that we'll answer revolve around the pace car, the scoring system, and more.
Inside NEXTEL Cup is presented by NEXTEL, helping NASCAR groups get things done. NASCAR and NEXTEL, partners in speed. Brought to you in part by High Endurance Oils from Mobil, official lubricants of NASCAR, and by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
On Inside NEXTEL Cup Racing, our expert panel reviews Sunday's GFS Marketplace 400 from the Michigan International Speedway. GFS standing for Gordon Food Service.
Yes, and Mr. Gordon was there. And you know what he did? They gave us plenty of steaks at the motorhome lot to cook. And
such a great group.
Oh, GFS.
That shrimp was awesome.
It was. We just have to thank them for their involvement on the weekend. They did it a little bit better than most do. You see the highlights or the facts of the race. 26 cars finished on the lead lap. Now, technically, I think I finished on the lead lap. Let me get y'all's opinion on this.
Stop. Let's do it this way. Where'd you finish?
It doesn't matter. I finished
where you finished?
It doesn't matter. I'm not arguing where I finished. Would you be quiet? You don't know what you're talking about.
26 were on the lead lap.
I finished 27. Listen, Alan, I was on pit road when the checker flag flew.
Yeah.
Okay? So, Jeremy takes the checker. The race is over. Boom. It's over. Doesn't matter what he does after that.
Doesn't matter what he does after
right.
that.
Right. Well, I'm past the start-finish line.
You didn't finish. You had only finished 199.
Be quiet.
You only finished 199. It's over.
Schrader, you don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah,
I mean, it's funny when you say things and you actually have some sort
of.
I did go back around, brother. I left pit road and drove around and completed lap 200. Now, technically, if Jeremy passed me after the checkered, you would say, if it had been not the checkered, I would have been a lap down because I might not have got off pit road before he did. But you see, his race ended at the start-finish line. And I left and drove all the way around and finished the lap. I finished 200 laps. There's no way to argue that.
What did their electronic timing and scoring
system show? Would you pick up
shots? No, none. It doesn't matter. It's just a technicality. Technically, by the rules, it should say I finished 200 laps.
Did you drive back around?
I did.
The racetrack?
Yes, sir.
And then make a whole nother lap?
I left pit road and drove all the way around and completed my last lap. I ran out with two to go, coasted to the pit.
You went
to the
past start-finish line, or did you come into pits?
I went down pit road and completed 199,
and I left. The line.
You're wrong. Somebody's wrong,
apparently.
No, I'm not wrong.
You're
NASCAR
wrong.
NASCAR would be wrong. So
both of you are wrong.
Let's get them all on the phone. We'll get done here.
Well, I think they'll probably change it. I bet you it'll show officially I completed 200 laps when they get it all figured out. But it said right now I did 199. But I think it's 200. Wouldn't you agree, Johnny?
Yep.
Yeah.
This whole thing is wrong, so let's move on. Why was the Michigan Grandstand sold out for a 30th straight time?
That's
good racing.
Oh, wow, it's fun to race in Michigan. You know what was interesting? In the Busch race, you didn't see guys going up next to the wall, but in the Cup race, everybody went everywhere, just like they always did.
Yeah, I started venturing right up to the top right away, and it was a great place to be up there.
Bottom to the top. That's what we just love about a racetrack like Michigan.
Have some options.
Oh, man, it's wonderful.
You know, there are other places where the track is as wide. Why is this one so usable?
Well, I think it's because the pavement has really, really matured. It's given up some grip, so you got to travel every which way.
And it's smooth, and they haven't done anything to it.
Right, and you see the same thing at Chicago and Kansas now, where the grooves widened out. It's just,
Texas was right on the bottom, and now
it's everywhere.
Everywhere.
Yeah. Just takes a little time for our big old heavy stock cars to grind enough grip off the bottom to where you got to say, well, I'm going to travel up to the top and see what it's like. Just a little bit of time.
I also comes to mind that the transitions in and out of the corners at Michigan aren't so harsh that
right.
that it gives you, it helps give you more options when you're going through there.
You're right, and that's what's wrong with Bristol. For some reason, when they concreted it after it was asphalt, the transition into the corners are just impossible to do anything but right on the bottom. And so that's why everybody runs down through there. After further review, I'm not sure grinding it would help a thing. It's those transitions into the corner.
The last 5 years of politicking to get it ground?
I think I was wrong.
No.
And I think Rusty was wrong about Martinsville, and that worked out perfect. So maybe my being wrong might be an advantage.
Only time will tell. Early in the June race at Michigan, there were troubles with tires, mostly right fronts, and troubles that went away as the race went on. Sunday, this Sunday at Michigan, left rears.
Was it a common thread?
Early in the race, a common thread.
I didn't know that.
That's what I'm asking.
I would think that would be, I would think it'd be fluky.
Yeah, I do too. Is that another left rear?
Yeah.
Oh, I know why his went flat.
Yes.
He got run into. Accidentally.
Did you do it?
Yeah. Oh, that was pretty cool. He did that on purpose. I'm proud of him.
Yeah, we could. That was perfect for us. Look how good.
I didn't mean to hit him, but I did. So, you know, that's what a driver says.
Yeah, it was just one of them racing deals.
Yeah, you said last week you were going to be all right.
I just didn't mean to. We didn't wreck. We just both kind of bumped into one another.
Maybe that was the common thread then.
Yeah, that didn't have anything to do with it. Well, maybe somebody hit Jeff in the left ear too, flattened his tire.
Next topic, trash.
Wasn't me.
There were plenty of people who had troubles with trash.
Look at
Sunday.
That.
Michigan, was all the time. It's strange. Always got trash on the racetrack.
And NASCAR blew the track.
Yeah, so is California.
Yeah. Huh.
This led to an ultimate engine failure.
Yes, it did. Mm-hmm.
That was Kyle at lap 54. Here's Casey Kane at lap 61. We'll see Rusty Wallace come in.
You're supposed to try to bump into people in the back when you get that on there. The crew chief tells you to try to draft it off there. And sometimes you can work it that way, but most of the time it's as thick as Casey's was. You don't really have that option. That's a pretty car, isn't it? Those racing stripes on it?
Mm-hmm.
There's Rusty's last ride in Michigan.
Tons of debris.
From behind the wheel, do you notice the temperature gauge?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, do you look at it often enough to see it going up?
Yeah, tracks like Michigan where you run as much tape as possible and as much drafting as you do, you have to watch that. You got to duck out every once in a while just to drop it 5, 10 degrees in temperature, get back in line. At times you keep dropping out, and you notice it's not going down as quick as normal. You
Plus
know you got some trash on there.
Your crew will give you a heads up. You got a little trash on there. You all right? How's your temperature?
I heard Greg Biffle say on his radio he picked up something across his grill once, and he was talking about the handling of the car, and he didn't know he had something on the grill, and then he saw it blow off, and the handling of the car changed. And he said, okay, now I understand what was going on.
Right.
How does the handling of the car change when you pick up something on the grill?
Just like adding tape makes more front downforce to make the car turn better or be a little bit looser and stuff. I mean, it just plants the front end of that car.
More trash talk. Trash talk. I sound like you trying to open the show. More trash talk.
No, you don't.
Shortly.
Give yourself a little bit more credit than that, Alan.
Thanks.
You know, I missed 3 weeks. And there's
now you're not.
I didn't miss everything.
We continue. If there were a bad luck award given out for the driver who had the most miserable rotten luck all year, Joe Nemechek would be this year's hands-down winner. He's leading at lap 74 when trouble. Right front.
Yeah, he knew it.
Yeah, he was trying to get down there in a hurry and just, it's still hard to get turned no matter what you look at. But it was unusual for Michigan to have right front problems.
And then he took this heap here that he's got torn all to pieces and ran the top 10 with it.
Yeah.
That's cool. He rebounded nicely.
Yeah, came back to finish eighth. They worked their strategy just
they've been
right.
Rebounding all year. I mean, the team's done a wonderful job.
Fast car, man. He was the fastest thing in both practices. And
qualifying, too.
Yeah, got the pole, so led the race. Good day for those guys.
We'll take a break on Inside NEXTEL Cup Racing at this point on the show. Coming up, a championship chase for the Yates team turned in the wrong direction. Those chasing a place in the chase for the NEXTEL Cup will need some above-average performances over the next 3 weeks You see average finishes at Bristol, California, and Richmond for the 11th to 15th place drivers.
Well, it's going to be fun to watch, be fun to be in it, playing too, but it's definitely going to be interesting to watch. Any one of those cats you see there are as likely to get in as the other. You see Dale and Elliott and Gordon haven't, and Harvick really haven't been performing overly well. Matt's on a roll. He is performing well, and he's the furthest out. So any Harvick won Bristol in the spring,
yep.
You know, and he always runs well at Richmond, so it's going to be interesting. And that's what I like about the chase. It's not only the chase to the championship. Now you got this chase to the chase to the championship. What are they going to have next? The prelude to the chase for the championship, I think.
Did you have like a big old thing of coffee just before we started taping the show?
I did. Did you?
Okay.
Could you tell?
Just wanted to check.
I went to the human bean. That's what it's called. Get it? Like the human bean. Coffee bean.
It's Inside NEXTEL Cup from Charlotte with our expert panel talking about human beans and hopefully Sunday's Michigan race with Michael, Johnny, and Kenny. Let's talk about a couple drivers trying to get into the championship chase who had some troubles on Sunday. Lap 81, a couple things happen at the same time that keep a rough stretch going for Elliott Sadler.
This was, I watched Kurt.
He just got loose.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah,
I watched Kyle blow up the lap before, and he was past that point when he blew up. That didn't have anything to do with the wreck. I think Elliott just got loose, and that's easy to do when you're racing tight like that.
Oh, it's extremely easy.
Watch Sterling.
Be looking for all. Be looking for all. The fire blew up. Be looking for all.
Yeah, we were not too far behind that, and you just seen him start to slide to back, and then
look at Schrader. This is Dale Jarrett. Jarrett going left. Dale Jarrett going right.
I didn't hit him.
No, you were ahead of him.
Yeah, okay.
Dan, hang that one on you, can.
Video provides clear evidence that you're okay. You've heard of 200-mile-an-hour tape before. So the crew's trying to keep the rear bumper cover from coming off. Don't quite get it done before he goes. Watch the roll of tape.
The tape almost stayed.
Yeah, the tape stayed. The bumper.
Look how far it goes.
I bet that tape's going, wee! Yeah.
There's where they got the 200-mile-an-hour tape.
I just thought that was so funny. Elliott said he got really loose behind a couple cars, and it just went around on him.
See, Schrader, I told you, when you're behind them, sometimes it makes you loose.
You just never know what's going to happen. Those cars there, I mean, they're just all the time, they're just, they're never in the track. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the old days, with the bias pipe tires and the springs that we ran then, you just turn on the wheel. They were stuck on a racetrack. Now they're just, but they're fun now. I mean, they're really fun to drive.
And two, it's always that way. You get down and you try to cross over that little bump there, and it gets pretty loose. And I saw Tony Stewart go through there once earlier in the race and about lost it too. He had a pretty good save there, just sliding her sideways all the way there, and
you can tell
kind of moved. But
that track is, they didn't mean to do it, I don't think, but it has some of that, variable banking. I'm not going to try to say that parabolical word ever
again. Yeah, no, you never do that.
I tried to say philanthropic the other day. That wasn't real bright of me. I knew I couldn't say it when I started to say it. But and for you guys, that means a charity.
Would be philanthropic, wouldn't it?
Philanthropic. See, I didn't even say it.
Okay.
I was thinking Hawaiian tropic, and then I said philanthropic, and I didn't say it right. But it's got that, doesn't it? You can,
yeah,
there's little creases that you run across, and your car will, you know, it's variable.
But we digress. Another unusual happening on Sunday happened to Casey Kane. He has a left rear shock that goes bad on his car.
It falls off. It the top fell off. I was following him.
Would it broke?
I could see an eye. I thought I could see an eye. I could see, you know, the top of the shock's flat, and then there was still something at the top. But
there's all there is.
Following him on the yellow, I was like, that's not right.
There's just a snap ring holding those Heim's eyes in on top, and it's very possible one just broke.
How must that have felt to be driving a car with a left rear shock not
probably
hooked
not too
up?
Good.
No, that would have not been good.
Better in the front, but
yeah, that's probably the least one that you would worry about, would you say?
Yeah.
I mean, if you had one, pick one to fall off, I'd pick that one.
Okay.
We move on. During that caution, which was for debris, Scott Riggs did not pit and took the lead. Greg Biffle's team took just right side tires, while Kurt Busch, who had been the leader, took four, and they went racing on the restart.
What was that sponsor on Biffle's car? Prism. Is it a game?
Yes, it's a program the National Guard has put out. It's almost like a military exercise simulation.
Ah, look at there.
Look at these Roush cars, and there's another one right out of view here. There he is. Three of them.
That's the same way every time at Michigan, it seems, doesn't it? But then did I hear he hasn't won there in quite some time?
Well, it would have been June, the Biffle one.
Yeah, like a couple months?
Yeah.
Corn dogs were burned here.
Oh, no, what happened to the corn dog ride, Johnny?
At first, we thought it broke, because we run hot a little earlier from the trash on there.
Looked like it was a little hot then.
Yeah, blowing some. Well, when I shut it off, it went way hot.
Okay.
But it ended up just putting a hole through an oil line. And so the engine was fine, everything ran good, and just kind of hit it for Michael and Bill Davis and everybody. We had a decent running going.
Well, the thing I like, Mr. Hooks and Mr. McLaren had a car in the race that was competitive. You ran well.
Ran good.
Got the free pass. Got a lap down on a
pit
stop.
Yeah, we were trying to get it out of qualifying trim, moving some stuff around. We got a little bit behind the ball there, but got back up and it was a little loose. And with the, you know, thought we could have run about 18th, so I was going to be happy with
that. Yeah, I think you could have too.
Under the caution.
You would open the show.
Yeah.
Under the caution with 71 laps to go, everyone pits and more overheating problems crop up. This time it's Greg Biffle. Well, first we see the pit stops.
And then we see the pit stops. Pit road speed was 4,600 RPM in second gear.
That crowd there.
The crowd was awesome. Julie Roberts sang the national anthem. And Sugar Land did a concert in the infield Saturday night. So MIS gets it, I think. They provide entertainment for everybody. And of course, the track is just second to none. We're talking about pit stops.
Watch Jimmy Johnson come out of his pit stall here.
The race off pit road. Whoa, Jimmy comes out.
Give once you can.
When those other cars are running 55 mile an hour, you got to get going. You got to get going quick.
Talk to me about the pressurized systems in these cars.
That's one thing that's great about the systems they have nowadays. If you're overheating and they put that, you see the water shooting up there on the window, both on my car and his. You know when you start to lose a little bit of water. So the crew just sticks this, they call it a water buffalo, but just plug it in there and jam water through there until it's full.
What's the advantage to having the system pressurized to the extent that they are?
The water boils at a higher temperature when it's pressurized. So instead of running 212 and boiling water out, you can run it.
You can run 240, 250 and still be okay.
And still maintain the water.
I finished Talladega in May, if y'all remember, without any water, running on the peg and ran like 10 laps like that. So it just somehow helps. Like Schrader says, it doesn't boil it all out as fast, and then also it continues to run a little bit longer when you are out of water because of the pressurization.
Well, it doesn't really help if you're out of water.
Well, I mean, as you're running out of water.
I just go by what you say.
It doesn't blow it out as fast.
Well, you know what I meant.
I can just go by what you say.
I thought one of the interesting behind-the-scenes thing that happened with Biffle's crew, all right, you're going to come down pit road, you've got to add water, but you're only allowed 7 men over the wall. Who's going to do it? And they sat and they made a plan and rearranged for one of the tire carriers to deal with adding the water and compensate elsewhere on the pit stop. And you know, that's not one of those things you're going to practice.
No, but
they made a plan.
And I mean, they came up with a good plan, and you know it's going to hurt your stop a little bit, but running this thing out of water is going to hurt your day a whole lot. So, you know, you just got to take that few extra seconds and get some water jammed in.
And you just take one of the extra guys that, when they get their job done, get over the wall and then send somebody else in.
I don't think you could send another guy over. I think once a guy goes over the wall, you can't swap people because they put that. I'm going back like a decade now.
I think you can. Yeah.
Did they? Because there was a time where they didn't allow you to do
it's
that.
It's a seven.
Seven at the same time.
Yeah.
Maybe it was you couldn't take an air gun back and forth
no.
over the wall.
Well, that you can.
Yeah, okay. I'm confused. But working with these guys, it's easy to see why. Coming up next on Inside NEXTEL Cup Racing.
No, it's not easy to see why.
No.
Because we're confused. So
we're all against you
can't
there.
Tell who's confused.
We continue on Inside NEXTEL Cup Racing, reviewing the GFS Marketplace 400 from Sunday at Michigan International Speedway with Michael, Johnny, and Kenny. Now we get down to the part of the race where a lot of things start happening all at once that really change the outcome. First, caution at lap 142 for debris from this incident.
It looked like he had a flat, didn't he? Yeah, left rear.
Stuart Kirby and Travis Quappel.
Travis just in the wrong place. He had a pretty good run going, old Travis did.
Looked like it last minute. I think I can fit through there.
Now it's time to play pit strategy roulette.
Some do, some don't. Some will, some won't. You'll have that.
What did your teams do here and why?
Well, what I did and why was pitted because I was handling crappy. And then we repitted with one to go.
This was, when I saw these guys all come down pit road, then it's like, you know, there's some of these guys think they can make it.
Right. And the, but there were very few that did, Kenny. Gordon came back in. I came back in. Some of the, Jeremy came back in late.
And good thing you came back in.
No, I wish I had it now. No, I had to come in. I was not going to finish very well either way because of a handling problem that maybe I brought on myself. I'm not sure.
No.
I might have bumped into the zero car and knocked something off my
steering wheel. You already said you did.
Well, it was just a very slight rub. I mean, it wasn't nothing to me.
It's not what he thought.
Yeah. Worked out worse for him, but it just, my car just, it was a great car on
Friday.
Okay,
enough about your car. We'll be back. This is where
Saturday. Jimmy Fenn and Kurt Busch, crew chief, said they did not pit there because they were going to have to stop once more to make the finish anyway, and it wasn't going to gain them anything to stop there.
Plus, obviously, they were handling well. They were running up front, you know, so if you had a good car, it was easy not to stop because you had to stop again anyway.
Plus, right there, when you're, like I said, when you're running up front like that, it's like, okay, I don't want to roll the dice and try to make it the rest of the way. That means I got to check up, let these guys go by and coast. Let me just keep going real fast, come in, get my tires, go back out, and hope none of them make it.
Kurt Busch is leading, Matt Kenseth is chasing, and they get into a really interesting situation with 36 laps to go. There's stuff on the 17's grill as he's taking the lead from Kurt. And Robbie Reiser jumps on the radio, and together with Matt's spotter and Kurt Busch's spotter, they do a little ballet to get that stuff off the grill of the 17 car.
Well, that goes back to what we were talking about earlier, is get back. He's going to swap back and forth here. Let me come up and hit you. Hate to do this at 190-some mile an hour, but they'll do anything they can to get the tape off that thing or to get the debris off there.
And you can see him, watch Matt try to switch lanes to get the air to suck it off, and then eventually he'll get right, there it goes. He gets right on him and it pulls it off.
That's neat.
That's teamwork, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's where you had to have a teammate to do that with.
You either had to have a teammate or a really fast car and a sucker. You know, somebody didn't know what you were doing, and you just start messing with them until you get it off.
Right.
Well, plus, they had the advantage. I mean, look behind them. They got room to play with.
And with TV today, you know, they get right on that, and they're sitting on a box to see it fly off. He can relay that right to Matt and says, go back to your business. It's gone.
Wonder how hot his temperature got. That was covered.
That was covered. Yeah.
I mean, he had to get that off in a hurry.
Yeah. They did a very nice job. With 26 laps to go, a new player arrives on the lead scene. This would be Cousin Carl.
Comes Chase Matt down, and those two thought they were racing for the win at the end. They definitely had the two fastest cars.
So Carl goes by Matt for the lead. Then with 20 laps to go, no caution in sight. Kenseth and Busch, who've done a lot of the leading through this second half of the race, have to come to pit road under green.
And you can see there, they're prepared. They got the left side tires up on the wall, prepared to do four, but decided to just take two.
97 car does go for all four. And so Matt will get out ahead of Kurt. 18 laps to go now. More pit stops and pit strategy. Mark Martin's been called to pit road. Then at the last second, there's something that comes on the NASCAR radio. Well, maybe there's going to be a caution, and they tell him to stay out.
The 77 car laid down a bunch of smoke, I think.
Yep. So Mark kind of lost a lot of momentum there, having to come back around to pit road. Now you see, once Kenseth made his two-tire thing, now everybody else is going to go for something different, or as quickly as they can.
Dale Jr. just gets gas.
And our Enterprise turning point of the race, the fact that these guys didn't stop.
How far back did he get in that last segment?
You mean restarted?
Yes, sir.
He restarted about 27th. or 28, because that's where we all restarted. Me, him, Gordon, Nemechek, a bunch of us.
The only time I noticed it enough to write it down, I had him at 23rd.
Right. He would have been 23rd, 5th, 7th, something like that.
It's a good gamble for them to.
He ran fast enough to win the race, and he's got enough gas to do donuts.
But he's got no left rear tire now, so he's stuck in the grass.
Well, he doesn't care. He's got $181,550 to
buy another tire.
Heck yeah.
Okay, so you want to know where my $3,386 per gallon came from?
Yeah, not really.
Difference in winning from first to third.
Right. Yeah, but I was with Schrader on that.
We did 20 laps and so on.
We didn't really care.
That's kind of what I figured, by the way.
But that's where he got it from.
I finished 27th, if anybody cares.
Yeah, first car lap down.
First car, last car to leave last. I'm going to have to call and ask them about this.
Do you think that by Tuesday morning they'll know that you're going to express concerns about this?
I'm not really concerned. I like things to be the way they're supposed to be.
Never mind.
Goodbye.
Here are the championship standings with three races to go until the chase for the NEXTEL Cup. Effect of Sunday's race, Tony Stewart's locked in. He could not even start the next three races, and he'd be in the chase for the championship. Jeremy Mayfield now has a 218-point gap on 11th. That's the numbers you're looking at. The distance these top 10 guys are ahead of 11th place, which is the key number.
It is. Jeremy got him a lot of breathing room, but look at cousin Carl and Jamie. You know, that's 50 points. That's you like that right now.
Had a huge Sunday. That's
yes, for him going those guys all had a huge Sunday.
Now the guys chasing in the distance, they are behind 10th. You know, 51 points for Dale Jarrett. You say, well, that's not a lot. Well, it can be in three races.
It could be.
Especially if you run. Look at the. Here's what you got to consider, Alan. All the people that he has to outrun in order to get to 10th. You know, the 51 points that he's behind 10th isn't as big a deal as the fact that Jeff Gordon, Elliott Sadler, Kevin Harvick, and Matt Kenseth are all right there to change places with him.
Well, plus, if he gains those 51 points, he has to hope Jeff Gordon doesn't gain 59
exactly,
or Elliott gains 67.
You look forward and you look back. It's just confusing no matter which way
it's
you look.
Neat. It's close. Is neat.
Up next, a late laps pass for the win in Saturday's NASCAR Busch Series race at Michigan. Highlights in a minute. We go with the Domino's Pizza 250 for the NASCAR Busch Series Saturday in Michigan. About a 50-minute delay for rain slowed the proceedings. When the green flag waved, Clint Bowyer raced Martin Truex hard for the lead in those five championship bonus points.
That was a great move by Clint to get out in front of Martin there and grab those points.
Bowyer led 62 laps the most. Greg Biffle led 44. His car especially strong on the long green flag lanes.
And we saw a lot of that on Saturday, as you will at Michigan.
We move ahead to further action. Fourth caution of the race when Paul Wolf spun with 16 laps to go.
Picked up that little wobble.
Will you at least show the Domino's Pizza Chevy getting my lap back?
Unfortunately, Mike, we're way late. No. But here's your chance to talk about it real quick.
I made the three pass back and got up to 16th in what was otherwise a dismal day for the Domino's Pizza Chevy.
Let's see. This is
Reed.
We showed pit stops. Then third place driver in points, Reed Sorensen, had troubles. And while he's slowing, no caution yet, Biffle gets around Harvick. Now the caution.
That'll leave a mark.
Harvick was on no tires, so he was in trouble.
And even with 10 to go, he still come down pit road to put tires on.
He did and finished 15th or 13th, I think.
Here it is, final restart with 6 to go.
This is a strong move right here by Ryan Newman to be able to drive that thing down under Greg and complete the pass. We see people get down below guys routinely and not able to seal the deal, but he pulls it off.
He was able to get in front of them before they come up off the corner, which helped a bunch. And these guys had a great run for second place all the way to the line. And it was pretty wild. Got a little interesting right here, a little bit of wobble. It was pretty wild.
Whoops. Come on now. Stick, baby. That's what he's saying. But he couldn't quite pull it off.
Not quite.
Ryan Newman wins his second NASCAR Busch Series race in a row.
How about this? Four starts this year, two wins, two third-place finishes.
Not a bad average.
Yep. Big talking point on this one was the second-place driver in the championship, Clint Bowyer. Came down pit road at lap 87 for a pit stop. Had led the most laps on the day, but watch the fueling operation here. They can't get any fuel in the car.
Why is that?
That's what I asked that question yesterday.
Stay with it, stay with it.
And they did not have an answer for me
as of yesterday. I bet they have one today. Paul Menard continues a hot streak. He gets another top 10 finish. Passed two cars in the last couple of laps to finish sixth.
By the way, that the problem fueling for Clint means he had to come back down pit road 15 laps later under green. He wound up finishing 30th.
Wow.
Fast car 30th. You're going to see that more and more in NASCAR racing as we go forward. You can take a car that you could win with, have one bobble and finish 29th, 33rd with it, 34th. I mean, it's amazing the competition level.
So instead of being down 122 points like he was entering the race, Bowyer's now down 204 to Truex in the Busch Series Championship. They race at Bristol Friday night. Where to find things on TV this weekend?
We got it going on here on Speed.
Craftsman Truck Series Wednesday from Bristol.
Won't that be fun?
Always.
Huh?
Looking
always
forward to running that Federated Outparts truck in that race.
You got the pole last year, didn't you?
Yeah, the pole.
Cool. Yeah. I'll be in the booth. Can I call you up and ask out there?
Yeah, no.
All right.
Trackside on Speed Friday from Bristol, 10 p.m. Eastern Time, part of the lineup of NASCAR TV from Thunder Valley. Coming up this weekend. 8 zillion people and a lot of racing.
Yeah,
that's great.
And Speed will be in the middle of all of it. Now, your questions for our expert panel, Speed Fan Q&A, initiating this week from Oakhurst, California. Pam wants to know, if there's a limit on how long a car can stay on pit road and be worked on.
Yes, there is. You know, they have to be reasonable on what they're trying to accomplish. If you've got a fender that's bent and a crush panel that needs knocked out, you can do all that. But if you come sliding in there with a busted radiator, they'll send you behind the wall to fix that.
But I don't know if there's a set time.
It's just reasonable.
Sometimes
it's a good word for it.
Sometimes you see somebody get in the middle of something and then become a little more involved and someone's on pit road longer than you think they should be, but they got into it first. So.
And the reasons for making someone go behind the wall, A, safety. Guy's laying down underneath the race car. He's not seeing the oncoming traffic. And B, courtesy for other drivers who may have to pit in and around that car as the race goes on.
Yep.
Alan of Madison Heights, Virginia, wants to know why, when he watches or attends a NASCAR race, he sees a counting device next to the flag stand. What is it?
That's what is now the, I guess, Trader, correct me if I'm wrong, not that I have to tell you that, but is the backup scoring system. They manually write those numbers down as a car crosses the start-finish line to make sure that they have a written document to look at to settle scoring disputes should something happen to what is now the primary source for scoring and timing, the computer.
But scores are inside.
Not at that track. That was Martinsville.
Then that's what it'd be. It used to be our primary system.
Sometimes that line may not be at the start and finish line. Maybe a different place on a track over in turn 3 or 4. It's just a backup system in case something goes down.
Exactly correct.
Ding, 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 ding.
Got a question for our panel. Here's how you find us.
To email us your question, visit speedtv.com. Go to the program section and look for Inside NEXTEL Cup. Inside NEXTEL Cup is presented by NEXTEL, helping NASCAR groups get things done. NASCAR NEXTEL partners in Speed. Brought to you in part by Enterprise Rental Car. Call 1-800-RENT-A-CAR. Pick Enterprise, we'll pick you up. And by High Endurance Oils from Mobil, official lubricants of NASCAR.
Tuesday night on NASCAR Nation at 7 o'clock Eastern Time is Mikey Mite.
Tony Urie Jr. and Pops, Tony Sr., they're big RC guys. They really get into this stuff. And so I'm driving the 15 there. But watch. I get back on the road and I make a pass. It's fun to do that, but it's hard to do.
Oh, it is, especially when it's coming back at you.
And I'm supposed to say who put that on, but I forgot. So watch tomorrow night and you'll see it.
See it in the full feature.
You got it. Wednesday night, nice. In case it's time to do this Wednesday
yes,
night,
yes.
I'm going to be on speed doing the truck race, watching Schrader and his truck. Friday night, I'm going to race the Aaron's Dream Machine in the 250. And then Saturday night, of course, I'll be in the Napa Chevy. And JB is going to drive the Brian's Meats Chevy, the Taste of the South, for me in the Cup race.
And I'm not sure if Kenny's going to watch me drive in a truck race, but I'll be there on Wednesday, too. Call on anytime.
Very nice. I can call you, too.
Yeah,
absolutely. There'll probably be a chance that we'll meet up somewhere in the course of the night. Dan's in Bristol, but looking forward to taking Federated Truck in the Schwann's Home Service Dodge. And we're going to be in our wind tunnel Sunday night, too. Looking
you
forward
are?
To that.
Yeah. Cool. I'll deliver you a Domino's pizza over.
I'll just probably stick a Red Baron frozen pizza in the oven. I'll be fine. Thank you, sir.
Well, I'll tell you
we
what.
We just can't agree on anything, can we, Alan?
If anything, today we've covered every possible sponsor angle. And maybe a few more that are still in the works. Who knows? All right, we'll do it again next Monday. See you then.